Mission in China alone until February 23rd, at least 77,600 cases were reported of infection. Over 2,000 is death toll, and that's not enough. Italy, you have 200 cases plus. Kuwait, Bahrain, Oman, Afghanistan, and Iraq also are reporting first cases of this virus. And that's why it's important to know what should one do. And here's the person to tell us all about it firsthand. 26-year-old professional Arushi, who's just come back from Hong Kong and has been staying in Delhi for the past 2 weeks. Let's speak to her. I think she heard me, right? Should I try again? Hi. Thank you for letting us in.
Yeah, please come.
Are we the first visitors after your self-imposed quarantine?
Perhaps, yes. I think so.
Oh my God. So you came like 2 weeks back from Hong Kong. Can you tell us what's the situation there and what happened?
So at the moment in Hong Kong, there's a crisis in terms of the coronavirus outbreak. So people are just taking a lot of precautionary measures to be at home and to not roam around on the streets, take public transport, and there's a work from home situation in most companies. And people are just trying to be safe, and most transportation has been blocked to China. A lot of the ports, for example, the Hong Kong MTR, which is our metro, it no longer goes to Shenzhen. So people are trying to be contained as much as possible.
But you've been off from work for now literally 5 weeks, isn't it? 3 weeks you were in self-imposed quarantine in Hong Kong, and when you came back to India, it's been 14 days, and mostly confined to your house because you don't want to risk an infection. But were you scared the first time when the news broke out? What were your immediate steps?
Yes, I was scared, but my immediate step was not to panic, because I do have a lot of family in India who were panicking for me. So my steps were to take precautions, wash my hands, to not go out unless it's absolutely necessary, to wear a mask, and to, if, for example, I fell ill for 1 day, so I stayed at home for 3 days and took complete precaution, went to the doctor, and take care of my mental health. And well, speak to more people about
it. Well, it's interesting that you say that, take care of my mental health, because I know that any time that there is news spreading, there's also fake news spreading. So how did you keep yourself abreast about not panicking? There is an app, I believe, that you used in Hong Kong. Can you tell us a little bit more about it? It's still on your phone?
Yes, it is. Yeah. This has been extremely helpful. And I have some friends who do thorough research. So this, you can see, it's called wars.voteforhk. And on this is a local app that has been developed by Hong Kong citizens themselves, wherein you can see the total number of cases in Hong Kong.
I believe it's 84 infected as of now, and 2 deaths in Hong Kong. So it's kind of scary. Look at that number, 84, which has gone up by 7 from last count. Yes. 116 investigating, and at least 1,731 have been reported. And is this an app which is being used by mostly people, young people in Hong Kong, or how popular has it become?
It's quite popular at the moment, at least amongst the expats, since it's completely in English and most of the information is in Chinese at the moment. And it's being used by a lot of young people.
And you mentioned that you used one specific thing, which is health tips. Can you show us what's health tips in this one? Yeah.
So here you have various articles by sources such as WHO, which are telling you some very useful information. So for example, here you have real-time infection and death numbers. You have some health tips regarding where to go and how to stay safe, how to do a good hand rub and hand wash.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And did you practice this? Did you practice a good hand wash?
Yes, I try to do that as much as possible. I'm not able to follow all of the steps properly, but I got a tip from a friend who asked me to sing Happy Birthday to You twice, the whole song.
Okay. Happy Birthday to You while washing your hands.
Yes.
Oh my God. But apart from this, tell us, was there also a concern amongst people about masks? Because we've been getting reports of how masks are running out, especially in China at the moment.
Yes.
And it's horrible to see. In South Korea yesterday, BBC reported there were huge long queues of people trying to buy masks.
Yes, it's quite a challenge in Hong Kong. You know, people are sitting outside pharmacies, 50 to 100 you know, people sitting outside for hours overnight. I see old people sitting. And Hong Kong, believe it or not, there is a lot of disparity. So the poor, they're not able to get access to masks. And mask prices have been hiked. It's insane. I think it has gone from around 5 to 10 rupees to about 90 rupees for just a simple surgical mask. Exactly.
And tell us also about the toilet paper scarcity. I mean, what was that about? Was the toilet paper scarce when you were there as well?
Yes, it was. I went to my local supermarket and there were no toilet papers to be found. So people are just hoarding because they think the toilet papers will go out. And I don't think there is a relationship between hygiene and toilet papers.
And what about workplaces? Yeah. What are they saying? Because I know you have your computer right here. Yeah. So this is Arushi's workstation right now, that corner. But is your workplace giving you the leeway to work from home? Have they been understanding?
Yes, they've been very understanding. I work for a small company, it's a startup, and despite that, they have been very understanding in terms of working from home.
And I mean, look at this, in Hong Kong as well, one saw that there was entire student protest movement. Obviously, it also impacted tourism there, impacted the students who are going there for education from India, and now there's a coronavirus scare. It's impacting the economy also in a bigger way, but small startups, as you mentioned, if they are allowing you to work from home, but what about big offices? Are people going to work, or what have you experienced?
So I work with clients in MNCs and they have the option to either stay at home or go to work, and they have proper checks in their buildings, temperature checks, and their buildings are maintained very well. So they are able to go to work, but of course they can afford to have their employees to stay at home.
All right, take us. So Arushi has this go-to kit. Yes. Isn't it? Now, can you tell us what is this go-to kit all about? And how it helped you? And do you still carry it here in India as well?
In India, I've mostly been staying at home. Okay. So it's mostly I've used it in Hong Kong. Okay. But I try to carry it here. So I have a few masks that I would like to show you. And I have three types of masks. So one is the standard surgical mask. It's a very simple one. And you need to be aware that the hard side, which needs to be on the top on your nose. So this one is the most common, it's the cheapest, it's affordable, and I think this is enough. The second one is the N95. This is a slightly more well-structured mask, and it protects you from smaller particles as well. And the hard part is supposed to stay on your nose, and you're supposed to enclose it very tightly on your nose so that the air doesn't go out. And these two bands, you're supposed to stretch them and wear it over your head. So I tend to switch between the two. On a day-to-day basis, I wear this one and this one for traveling purposes. And I have a third one. This is a more eco-friendly mask. It's similar to the N95, but you can easily wash it. But you need to make sure that you wash it regularly, at least once every 2 days.
Okay. Yeah. And there's also hand sanitizer. And times when you have to clean your jacket. I mean, were you doing that regularly in Hong Kong? Imagine the hassle in life when you have to clean your jacket before going out.
Yes, so I do have a denim jacket and a leather jacket, which I clean with these alcohol swabs, because I do tend to rarely travel on public transport. Mm-hmm. And my jacket touches the surface on the seat that I'm sitting on. So I use this, and I also use the alcohol swabs for my phone, my laptop screen, things that I wouldn't clean regularly before, even my Kindle. So I also have this sanitizer, and I have a spray which I use to disinfect my glasses as well, my sunglasses and my regular glasses.
And is that something that you observed other people doing regularly as well? And it got into habit. I can imagine the fear with which you're cleaning it every time. Yeah. How many times in a day did you do that?
At least twice a day I tend to clean it, morning and evening. Yeah. And I see people doing it more.
All yeah. Right. And what are the other precautions they are taking? I mean, this is something which is a precautionary measure to keep yourself disinfected. But what are the other precautions? Like, do you use public loos? What about, you can't avoid the train all the time. So you go in a train. And, you know, what are the apprehensions then in your mind?
I try to travel during non-peak hours. Mm-hmm. I wear gloves when I'm on the train. When I have to take it, I take it. You have to be courageous as well. The city needs people to be roaming around. And I try to avoid gatherings. So parties or big meetings, I avoid those. And of course, I try to get more and more fresh air so that my immune system is functioning and is good. And I also drink a lot of vitamin C, which helps. And eat healthy. I don't take out anymore. So I cook. I buy more groceries these days. It's important to take care of your day-to-day health as well, you know, other than keeping everything clean. Yeah.
So tell us, apart from, you know, going to work, what are the other areas of life? Like you said, you were eating in, but what about going to the gym? Was it impacted as well? I mean, did you change your schedule?
Yes, I was so upset because I used to go to my favorite Zumba class and yoga class, and that's been canceled. So alternatively, I do yoga at home. So I have a yoga room. Fortunately, I don't have a flatmate at the moment because of the coronavirus situation. So I have yoga at home, and rarely I go out for runs as well. I have a beautiful park close by, so I wear my mask and I go for a run. But I'm very upset that my classes have all been cancelled.
So they were cancelled. It's not that you opted out, but people generally didn't want to come for any sort of a group activity that place. And that's one of the major, major hurdles as well. Yeah. Families, how are they surviving, especially with little children?
Yes.
What is it that they are doing at the moment?
Yeah, unfortunately for local families, there's not much they can do. Yeah, because at the moment, there are very limited things that the children can do. You can't really go to parks or public meetings, public gatherings. Expats, I know, have some friends who have taken their kids out and they've gone back to their respective countries. But for local families, it's quite challenging. And also for the homeless, it's quite challenging. And I know quite a few charities who are actively packaging food these days and going out of their way to go and distribute food in Hong Kong. Yeah.
We have a question right now from Tulika, who's asking, what are some of the common myths related to coronavirus? So what are the common myths that you find related to coronavirus?
I think a myth would be that you can catch it just from thin air without any contact. And there are also all sorts of myths right now that at the moment, you can't really go out of your house at all. Like, you have to stay in. The moment you exit, you will get it. You can't travel. If someone even slightly sneezes or coughs, you have to run the other direction. So people are quite scared and they're isolating each other. And I don't think all of this is true. As long as you maintain correct distance, which is 2 meters from a person, you can freely go about doing your day-to-day activities.
My producer was saying, people are saying, don't eat Chinese food. I mean, there are some people saying, don't eat Chinese food. I mean, that's to that extent, there's a paranoia. Yes. But when you came to India, what was the immediate reaction? Because there were these screening tests which have been installed at the airport. Yeah. Were you also screened?
Yes, I was screened. In fact, I have a photo that I can show us.
So, and in fact, that's not the only thing, because in India, at least, there's a constant screening process that's going on. Flights have also been disrupted because Indian government has issued advisory for citizens traveling abroad. The latest advisory has been traveling to Singapore. So there are certain regions where the Indian government has issued an advisory. And in fact, there's a photograph right now. If you come to the Indian airport, this is what you would be greeted at. If you're coming from certain regions, including Hong Kong, there'll be long lines where you're screened. What happens in the screening? Can you tell us, Arushi?
So it's quite a simple process. Firstly, you need to be wearing a mask. Second, they check your temperature by using a long elongated equipment that they point at your forehead. And the third one would be that you need to fill out a detailed form. And you need to sign that you haven't visited Wuhan in the past 14 days and whether or not you have any symptoms. And yeah, you need to attest to that.
So Wuhan being in China, and then as we also have, in fact, your mother right now. Hello, how are you? Thank you for coming in. And we also have a comment. Vasilaki says, I hope I pronounced it correctly. Apologies if I didn't help everyone from the coronavirus and control it. I do know that you were really anxious when Arushi was in Hong Kong. How many times did you call her in a day?
Many, many times. Yeah. Whenever I got time, I was calling her just to see how she was doing.
Were you at the airport to pick her up?
No, this was a big surprise.
Okay.
Yeah, so it was my birthday and Arushi surprised us. And more than that, I got surprises from everywhere because I was also asked from my workplace to sit at home.
And so you were a teacher, and once you told them your daughter is back from Hong Kong, they asked you to actually stay at home. So you've been at home for...
So what? it is a directive from the government of India to say that, and we do follow that strictly at workplace as well, and even at home. So the directive is that if you have a visitor or if you've met somebody in a particular frame of time or in a particular time period, then you need to inform. So I informed them that I have my daughter coming to India. She's visiting us. So I informed them. So once I informed them, they kind of asked me to stay at home for 2 weeks. So yeah, I was also quarantined.
And during this period, no classes, or were you taking classes via Skype? And
so the school already had arrangements. So I've been doing virtual lessons from home.
Okay. Yeah. Did you also cut down on your activity of going outside home?
I did. Yeah. I did, yes. And more
mother and daughter time at home, I can say. Yeah. More mother and daughter time at home. But what did you cut down on?
So basically I'm a Buddhist, mm-hmm. and I do a lot of I visit a lot of people to encourage them, and we chant together. Mm-hmm. So I've not been doing that at all, mm-hmm. Since she's come.
Whoa. Yeah. And what about going to malls and going shopping, going to watch cinema?
Haven't done that at all in these 2 weeks now.
And I must stress on the fact right now that there are no symptoms, and this is just a precautionary measure that you are taking and Arushi is taking. But Arushi, when you were in quarantine in Hong Kong, what did you miss the most?
I miss the freedom of walking out of my door and being able to do anything I would like. I missed, in fact, eating in restaurants. I'm a big foodie. I love exploring places in Hong Kong. And I miss partying, honestly.
Yeah. Well, Quan from China, and again, I'm sorry if I have not pronounced it correctly. I said the thing is that even experts are struggling to define how the virus is spread. So it's not a myth why there are so much misinformation. While I do urge people to visit the World Health Organization site, which is continuously updating as the information is coming in. Jyoti from India is asking, I would like to know if we can send school students for international programs to Europe, Russia, USA. Is it safe? Well, I won't be in the position to answer this, but I can actually get in Arushi's mother to ask if there's been any directive from schools right now for this.
Well, my school particularly has followed it very strictly, and we've cancelled all trips to the Southeast Asian countries. Conferences for teachers and trips for children, mm-hmm. both have been cancelled.
Okay. Yeah. Well, there you go, Jyoti. I hope this answers your question, but do take your school's advice in consideration, your doctor's advice as well. Medhavi is asking this to you, Arushi. Have you considered moving away from Hong Kong because of coronavirus scare at the moment?
I wouldn't lie. The thought has come to my mind, but solely because of the situation, I haven't thought of moving out of Hong Kong. It's my home, and I would take this decision very seriously.
But right now, what's been the hurdle of going back? I believe you've tried to book yourself on multiple flights, yes. but you've not been able to. So what's the nearest date or month that you're looking at to go back?
Probably April. Yes, so that would be 6 weeks from now. I booked my flight back on the 16th of February, which was cancelled. Again, booked it to 13th of March, again cancelled. So SpiceJet is being extremely cautious. Mm-hmm. Air India has shut down. IndiGo has shut down. I think Cathay is running a few flights, mm-hmm. but extremely expensive, and they will also be shutting down during March, so probably April.
But would you like to also wait till the time the scare is abated and there is also some yes. Some more information on how to deal with this latest virus? Because according to one of the reports in Reuters, the number of infections in coronavirus right now, so COVID-19, is actually 10 times more than SARS when it happened. So would you like to wait, even if the flights are there, so that at least the situation is under control and then you go back to your routine?
Yes, personally, I would like to wait. But if my work demands me to go back, unfortunately, I would have to. But yes, personally, I would like to wait.
Well, but Sachin also has one more question for you. Are you scared by the prospect of returning?
Returning to Hong Kong.
Yes.
I am not scared, to be honest. I think I'm well equipped with my kit.
Okay.
And I have enough information to kind of keep me safe. Okay. And I'm not really afraid of the prospect of
going. Let me ask your mother this, because are you scared? Are you scared that she's being this bold person saying, I have everything I need, but are you scared of her prospect of going back to Hong Kong now if there was an option available?
Yes.
Yes. Well, I know mother's heart. You know, the moment she said yes, I could figure out mother's heart. Waseem from India is asking, have you come across fake news? And if yes, how have you tried to tackle it?
I have come across fake news, yes, be it, you know, not eating meat, staying away from Chinese produce, and staying away from any human contact. So I have tried to tackle it by reading up on articles by WHO, by the correct sources online, and by having an engaging in a dialogue with my friends, so that we don't, you know, just get stuck in our own little boxes, but we actually engage in dialogues, and especially friends who are in the health industry and who are nurses and doctors.
So one thing that you were earlier talking about, Arushi, was also how to store your mask effectively, and not so that the infection doesn't spread, because once you wear it, this is how you need to store it. Can you share some tips with us, what you've learned?
Sure. I actually use a tissue papers, which I have at my desk.
Grab them quickly. And we'll show you how to store mask. Well, meanwhile, we also have another question. Rakesh from India is asking, how much time is the virus expected to be brought under control? Rakesh, I can tell you from the reports I've been reading that it is on a top priority. The World Health Organization has already called it a health emergency, and they are trying to nail it down, if I can use the word. But for more information, you can continuously visit the BBC online articles as well. We're keeping track of this quite substantially. Yes, Arushi, can you show us now that how are you planning to store these masks?
Sure. So first of all, I have a plastic bag, which I tend to disinfect using alcohol swabs. So I make sure that the plastic bag is also clean. Then I store my mask using two tissue papers. So firstly, you would put the first tissue paper on the bottom. You put your mask and you only hold it from the corners after washing your hands. Once you do that, you take the second piece of tissue paper, you put it on the top of the mask and you roll it. And then you would place it inside the plastic bag, which is already disinfected. So that's how I store my mask. And I would place it in my bag like this and close it properly. And also another thing to note is that you can do the same thing with the N95 and with the reusable mask as well. All right. And one important thing is that I was told by a nurse is that a mask has a life of only 6 hours. So if you wear it for half an hour, let's say from here to the supermarket, then there is a remaining life of 5.5 hours. So you should not use a mask for more than 6 hours, because the germs from your mouth, they accumulate on the mask itself. And if you wear it for more than 6 hours, and if you can't find a mask, let's say there's a shortage, it's better to not wear a mask than to wear it for more than 6 hours, and to make sure that you're not touching your face. Because the main reason why you wear a mask is not just to protect yourself from germs, but it's to protect yourself from your own hands. From being touched.
These little precautions could help. These little advice that you get through credible sources could help. But before we let you go, Arushi, one more message to your friends who are right now in Hong Kong. What would you like to say to them? And in a situation where I can already see from the questions coming in, there is a genuine concern and a genuine fear in the minds of people.
I understand there is a genuine fear at the moment, but we all must stay strong and we have to protect ourselves and to help our friends. And I think most important is to take care of our mental and physical health, because our bodies are meant to be active. We have to keep going for the good hormones to be created so that we don't fall into the, you know, cycle of negative thinking. So I would tell all my friends in Hong Kong, please stay positive, stay safe, eat well, stay hydrated, and, you know, keep happy and keep your families at home and in Hong Kong. Rest assured that you're fine.
All right. Yes. Thank you so much, Arushi. Glad that you're back in India with us. For now, the information that's coming from India is that there were 3 cases of coronavirus infection that were detected in Kerala, but now all of them have been declared fit. For now, India is prepared, and we also know that from Health Ministry, constant advisory is going out. So please do track all of that. Please do track all the credible sources as well. And if you've been watching right now, thank you so much. We carry on this conversation with health experts on Friday on Work Life India. You can also find us on our podcast, Work Life India. And it's a chat that we're talking about the hidden impact of coronavirus. So a lot of these questions that we've not been able to answer today, we'll be taking them up by the end of this week on Friday, 9 p.m. India time, 15:30 GMT. Thank you so much for being with us.